Song. Let's start out reading a scripture. 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies, and you anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let's pray. Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the awesome, mighty name of Jesus. Thank you and praise you for this opportunity to come and talk about you, and also to talk about our brother. And Lord, rejoice in his homecoming. I just pray that your peace and presence that surpasses all understanding be upon this assembly. And Lord, I pray for the family. I pray that your peace would be upon them. Lord, just direct us and use us. And Lord, I give you all the glory and all the praise in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. I was going to read the obituary, and I'm not going to. I tried to As a little boy, Jim and June coming up from sight was like great. You all knew most of you where we lived was in the middle of nowhere. There was no other kids to play with. My dad didn't. He did stuff. It was trout fishing or rabbit hunting or snowmobiling. I mean, we didn't have snowmobiles when I was a little kid, but we did stuff. And he always took me with me and at the end, and he always included me in. Remember, Jim would come up and if mom made chili and we sat there, he would butter about 10 pieces of bread and stack it beside me. And I would count them. You know, would butter as many and stack as many beside my bowl, and I would eat it. One thing I kind of forgot about till I was thinking about it is I had got a new shotgun for Christmas when I was 12, and it was a 5-shot automatic. We were hunting, and we were in a cornfield. We were standing side by side, and I probably had a beagle, and he was running the rabbit around, and the rabbit come right down the corn row right there. Last shot was right between my legs, and he never let me forget it. It's a wonder you have feet. He come up, and it was in the early spring. We were going to go trout fishing. We was going to go over by where his parents lived on the Cedar River. Little or how long ago that was, my dad had feet that were 9 feet. His little baby. Well, will not fit in. But we got to the river and we were walking back to the river, and as I stepped over a log, then later. And we were both kind of like, oh boy, Mark's not getting ready to go up north trout fishing up in Canada. By the end of the day, and you would stand in the river and it looked like two sailors. And we laugh all day long. And then we come home. I call up the waiters in the river. I left them. But I brought the suspenders home. And we're sitting at the table. Dad's working days. We know he's coming in. Jim and I are like. And he come in the house carrying the waiters with the suspenders because I left them in the garage. And he's going, Ethel, Ethel, what? All that's left is my suspenders. And they're ripped. And Jim and I lost. Well, it doesn't matter how much trouble. Sucker spearing. Tell you how many things we did, how much fun. I watched him with a lantern in one hand, a spear in the other, walking through the flats and pretty soon he just sat down. And we never made fun. Jim and I decided to go to the UP on a hunting trip, just him and I. So we loaded up my hunting camp and we loaded up chainsaws and we went up there and we cut enough wood. We each shot a deer relatively quickly. And I thought my dad was the king of snorers. My dad not. You cannot fake snorers. It would tear your throat out if you tried to snore. I would, you know. Now listen, I'm the guy that my wife used to vacuum the bedroom while I was sleeping on midnights, and I would never know it. But I would wake up in the night thinking, this is impossible. And I'd say, Jim, oh, was I snoring? I think. Hunting in Meredith, we both had hunting camps up there for a long time. We had a lot of fun. Cast iron wars, we called it. Cast iron on the cabin wall. Camping and fishing at Halton Lake. I don't know, there's so many memories. And in the end, that's all we have is our memories. Snowmobiling. When I first graduated, I moved to Saginaw and I lived there. Jim and I decided that we would cut wood, go to Meredith, cut a load of wood. And we both had. And occasionally they'd start. We would drive from Saginaw to Michigan, and we would tune them up. We'd have them down there first pull. And we'd go home with no wood. Go home and work on them all week. So the wood cutting business was not much money was made. I don't know. It's we had a lot of fun. We did a lot of fun. But I'm sure all of you have met. We're going to have another song now.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, would have put off all the things I had to do. Would have stayed a little longer, on a little tighter. Would I give one more day with you? There's a wound here in my heart, something's missing. And they tell me that it's gone and here's the time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased. And no many yours are here, it's even mine. The only scars in heaven won't be to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. The thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down. But the only scars in heaven from the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. Picked up your share of scars along the way. But now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. Fate is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken. Only a hope we make new. And the song that makes me smile now. Yes, the tears fall down. The only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you down. How I let you live. How I let you live. Not a day goes by that I succeed. Live on and on the better part. I'm standing with you in the sun. I'll fight this fight in this race I run until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken. And all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now. Even as the tears flow down. The only scars in heaven from the hands that hold me now.
About the scripture a lot is that in Romans 8, chapter 18, for consider that the suffering of this very present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed. The suffering that Jim has went through in his time in the nursing home with Jim, his wife, and in the things that's happened that doesn't seem good, doesn't even compare what's happening. You know, he's having the best day of his life. He's having more fun than he's ever had. You know, I think a lot of us think that when we get there, the main thing is going to be see our spouse or our kids or loved ones that's went before us. Today, right now, Jim knows more than all the theologians that are on this earth. He understands the Godhead three in one. I always wonder, it's like, when I get there, am I going to see God? But they're the Godhead three in one. How does that work? I don't understand. I want to sit down with God and say, all right, I've read your word and it said always was. But what? When did that start? No, it always was. I'm going to read Luke 16, 19. I'm going to read through this little passage of scripture, and then I'm going to come back and talk about it. And it was real funny when Joni called me and said she was going to have Jim's pastor. There was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and in fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, and who was laid at the gate, desiring to be fed from the crumbs that fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. So it was that the beggar died, and he was carried by angels to Abraham's bosom. And the rich man died, and being in torment in Hades, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried, said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip his finger in the water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham's son, remember that in your lifetime you received good things and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted and you are in torment. And besides all this, between us, there is a great gulf fixed so that those who want to pass from here cannot, and those who are there cannot pass to us. So we're going to go back and break that down a little bit. Before Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross and rose again. There was Hades and paradise in the center of the earth. They apparently could see each other. They could not pass because there was a great gulf between them that didn't allow one to go from one place to the other. But there's some things that's amazing to me. The rich man knew Abraham. Abraham had been dead for hundreds of years. So, and when it talked about Lazarus being in the bosom of Abraham, I kind of looked that up. That's a place of honor. He was in a place of honor. He said, having dipped his finger in the water. Whether we're in heaven, I found it odd that it said when the rich man died, Lazarus was dead. He was carried by angels. You know, none of us that are in Christ will never die alone. We'll be carried by angels into heaven. Think about Jim. Jim took his last breath. It was angels that escorted him. He went from his pain and suffering. Something to think about is the rich man and Lazarus. That story's real. That's not a parable. I know Jesus talked a lot about parables. That's not a parable. That's a real story. Because if it was a parable, it wouldn't have named names. Any other parable in the Bible has no names attached. This is a real story. That was 2,000 years ago. The rich man is still in torment. Lazarus is still having the best day of his life. You know, it says in the Bible, a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as a day of the Lord. You know, they haven't been there 5 minutes. Everybody that was in America, since it's been America that has passed away and is in Christ, it hasn't been a day yet. It's not going to end. We don't understand because everything we know has a beginning and it has an end. There is no end. There is no end, no matter which place. I had a dream. I had to tell you a dream I had about right after my death. And I never understood it completely. My dad, right after he died, I dreamed that he was on a gurney. And the head of the gurney was up against the wall. And in this dream, his head. And I believe that was God showing that he was birthed into heaven. Those hands reminded me of how a doctor would receive a baby. That's how it looked to my dad. My dad was birthed into heaven. And I believe it was the same way with Jim. I believe he went from here to paradise in such an easy fashion. No, he'll never. If you could ask him right now, do you want to come back? I talked to Joni, had mentioned that how much Jim liked music. She had mentioned that he always wished he'd learned to play the piano. He was very proud of the fact that he learned to play the dulcimer. Loved to play. Loved music. You know what kind of music's going on right now in heaven? That there's an angel choir that's like nothing we have ever heard. I just think Jim is walking around in such awe of everything he looks at, everything he does. It's a new experience. It's so exciting. Jealous of all the people that's going before me. It's like, verse 25, it said, but Abraham said, son, remember that in your lifetime you received the very good things, and likewise Lazarus, evil. But now he is comforted in here. And I noticed that when he is in torment, it's got an S on the end. He is in torment. It's not just one. But he said, I am tormented in this flame. Those that know Christ go into such paradise and such excitement and such a glorious thing that it says we can't even think or imagine what it'll be like. But those that go into torment are the same thing. We can't even think or imagine. To be in a fire and burning and in torment, and you want to die and you can't. And it's not for today. That rich man has been there 2,000. And 2,000 years from now, he'll be no closer to the end. But he will be in torment. Now, if I ask the ushers to come in here and say, listen, I have prepared a gift for you. And I have had it wrapped. Really got the bow on it. And they bring it in and they set it on each one of your laps. And you look at this gift, and it's a beautiful gift, and it's wrapped better than any gift you've ever had. They set it on your, I set it on your lap, and I say, okay, now you can open your gifts and see what you've received. And some of you open them and you're astounded at what I've given you. Some of you. Jesus made that gift. He made the gift of salvation, and it's free. And he said, it's so simple. I'm going to set it right here on your lap, and it's a beautiful gift. All you have to do is open it up. And it's so simple. All you have to do is ask him. And he does. And he forgives you of every sin. And he cleanses you whiter than snow. You can be where Jim is today. I don't care what kind of suffering you went through on this earth. What you've been through does not compare to what God has. I've had people ask me, how could a loving God send me to hell? And the answer is, and he won't. But he loves you enough. said, I desire no man to be lost. He said, I made hell for the devil and his angels. I did not make it for mankind. But I love you so much. But if that's your desire, God will never send you there. He gave you the free gift of salvation. He sent his son to die a horrible death on the cross. They're not rich. They're not dressed in purple. They're not eating something like the man. They don't have the new cars and the new boat and the new truck. They got a mansion. The suffering of this present time will not compare. I can look around the room and I can see some people in here that, especially one, him and I walked a pretty rough path. We weren't always on the right. I knew Jim. He had a little girl that decided to go to church and decided to start praying for her. And if you think prayer doesn't work, talk to my mother. Well, you can't know. That little girl. Don't give up on prayer. That gentleman that I was talking about that I said we didn't always walk on the right side, he opened that gift. Someday, maybe I'll stand here and talk about him. What a glorious day that'll be when we get to walk. How exciting is that? I have a go-to verse. I don't know if y'all have a life verse or not. My life verse for a long time. And I thought it was appropriate. Philippians 1:6. And it says, being confident of this very thing, that he, Jesus, who began a good work in you, will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Good work that was started in Jim the day he received that salvation. That good work was completed. Jesus, be confident of this very thing. Be confident knowing that the work that he started in you the minute you received salvation. Don't worry. Father God, we come to you in the awesome, mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we just thank you and praise you. Lord, we give you all the glory. We give you all the glory. We thank you for your salvation. We thank you for the lives that are in here right now that know you as their Savior. But Lord, if there's some that's lost, Lord, I just pray that you pull it. Lord, you said no one comes to the Father except the Spirit draw us. The Holy Spirit, we're asking right now that you touch their hearts, their minds, their soul. They would see their life. Just Lord, that they would know you as their Lord, that they would open that free gift that you made. I'm not going to embarrass anyone or ask you to come forward or ask anything like that, but if you'd like to see Christ is your Lord. You can do it right there in the seat that you're in right now. You can just pray. Just ask him, say, Lord, come into my heart. Save me from this flame, this eternal torment. Is that you? You want to raise your hand? Pray with me. After this, but you don't need me. Just ask me. Lord, I just thank you and praise you for the opportunity. Thank you for the opportunity to bring back memories that we have. Lord, I just what a glorious day. It's a day that you have made. And we can all change. Lord, I thank you and praise you. I give you glory and honor. I ask all this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to have
Oh, rest high.
From Jim always called benediction comes from Numbers. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you. Now, if we could dismiss from the back, if you'd like to come by.
You can come right up this way and cross over.
It concludes the service.